Push came from the highest court of this country for gender and religious parity this week. A two-judge bench of the Honorable Supreme Court ruled that a Muslim woman can seek maintenance from her husband after divorce under Section 125 of the CRPC. It is applicable to all married women, irrespective of religion, said the court. The bench said maintenance is not charity, but the right of married women, and it is applicable to all married women. Some strong observations were made by the court that have now triggered a mega debate. While this provision always existed in law and many Muslim women have taken this route to get what is rightfully theirs, is it now time to end this entire legal battle for them? Could this be the beginning to bring in perhaps a commonality or uniformity in civil contract laws? With this one instance of secular law superleding personal laws, would there be a precedent that is set across the board, and would that finally pave the way for a common civil code? Or a uniform civil code as is mandated in the directive principles of our constitution. States are already taking the lead. The Uttarakhand state could see UCC implementation by October this year. So are we ready for this equality pan Bharat? Let's dive into the conversation straight away. Tween Sinha, national spokesperson of the BJP with us. Kamru Chaudhary, political analyst with us. Amna Begum Ansari, activist with us. And in a short while, we should also have Asif Sohail, political analyst, joining with us. My namaste and Jai Hind to everybody. Thank you very, very much. Your first thoughts on this, Amna Begum Ansari. Are we ready as a nation for a common civil code? Because we know that the AIMIM wants to challenge this. The Jamiat Ulema-e Hind are already in a huddle looking at further legal action, saying this is just a two-judge bench. Where is the problem? Because somewhere it feels like deja vu. What happened with Shabanu case in 1985?
Yeah, I think it's not only about if we are ready for it or not. It is the need of the hour, because it has been 75 years, more than 75 years since freedom, that Indian Muslim women are still getting treatment of second class citizen, I would say, within the Muslim community. And we have seen at the time of the Shah Banu that Supreme Court that time also had given the right kind of judgment, which were in the favor of women protection. And the same thing is happening again. The only difference is that now we are more aware, and we have more hope from the current government, because they also have this UCC in their manifesto. So this idea is not anything against what BJP stand for. So in that regard, I am hopeful. Apart from that, now Muslim women are coming forward far more strongly for their right. If you will follow all these cases, this is filed by the Muslim women and won by them in the Supreme Court. So the women also are now more outspoken, are understanding that how they have faced discrimination in the name of the personal law. And all this opposition coming from, specifically from the male society of Muslims. If you would see the All India Muslim Personal Law Board, it's dominated by the men of the Muslim community. So they have a certain kind of authority in the name of Personal Law Board, and they do not want to let go this authority. This is the fight of ego, I would simply say, because we already follow secular law in the criminal procedure. So that time, if our Islam is not in any kind of danger, so how it will be in danger when we will follow in personal...
In civil procedures. In fact, it largely limits itself, the common civil code limits itself to five areas of civil procedures or civil engagements or civil contracts, that is marriage, divorce, death, inheritance and adoption. These are the five parameters. It does not challenge anybody's personal faith. But Tuhin Sinha, why is this to be or not to be, you know, two steps forward, one step back kind of an approach vis-a-vis the UCC? Or is the government somewhere going to leave it to the states? Because the directive principles also urge the states to try and move towards a common civil code.
Namaste, Anand. Namaste, everybody.
Namaste.
Well, you know, the UCC has been mandated by the directive principles of our constitution. It is also the BJP's ideological commitment. So I think, you know, it's a matter of time before we go ahead with it at the national level. That, in fact, is also a part of our manifesto. And all those people who have been in the habit of, you know, asking us, tariq kab bataoge, we tell the tariq without letting you know. Now, you know, obviously, when you look at history, there have been two incidents which have damaged the cause of UCC. One was in 1955, the Hindu Marriage Act, where, you know, Nehru could have easily extended that to every citizen. But then he, you know, he wanted to explore his pseudo-secularism and confine his pseudo-secularism to the Hindu community. 1986, you know, the way Rajiv Gandhi reversed the Shabano Act with a special act, that was the second major coup. But also in the present day, in contemporary politics, there are some political parties which are very inimical to the idea of UCC. And I think that is what makes our case very strong. For example, you know, in the series of videos that have come out of Bengal in the recent weeks, the way women have been flogged and the way a TMC MLA, two times MLA Hamidur Rahman, has justified it by calling that these are as per rules of the Muslim Rashtra. The way Jharkhand Congress MLA Irfan Ansari has rooted for Sharia law in the past, and the way Samajwadi Party leaders, whether it was Shafirul Barq or S.T. Hassan, the way they have rooted for Sharia, I think it makes it equally important for us to stay the course, and the BJP would be staying the course on it. One reason why the states have taken the lead is that, you know, it's a complex issue. It requires a lot of negotiation at multiple levels, especially today. You know, when there are certain parties which are clearly inimical to it, I haven't seen any political party apart from BJP support the Supreme Court stand day before yesterday on Muslim women having, you know, access to Section 125 of the CRPC to claim, you know, maintenance. So I think, you know, it's important that the state governments take the lead over here. And I think that would automatically pave the way for a consensus at the national level.
Kamru Chaudhary, where do you stand on this?
Yeah. First and foremost, we from the Congress mindset, we believe that the personal laws need an upgrade. There is no doubt about it. But the path towards the UCC should always run through the consensus. Even the directive principles of state policy have suggested that such things should be implemented on a consensus. But very funnily, when I was listening to Tuhin Sinha and a lot of BJP leaders in the past, I feel that the UCC has been portrayed as a political weapon to portray Muslims and other religious minorities as regressive. First and foremost, in 2018, the Law Commission said that UCC is neither necessary nor desirable, and secularism cannot contradict the plurality prevalent in the country. Such a wonderful statement that is. Now, if we want to implement the UCC in the country, has the Bharatiya Janata Party, despite the UCC being in their manifesto for the last 10 years, have they published a UCC draft? No. Then how do you develop a consensus on this regard? More importantly, if we suggest the names of player countries like the United States, who are having a uniform civil code, there also the Supreme Court has ruled that the different communities may follow traditional practices while the courts will interfere on the basis of the U.S. Constitution. In the case of what Amna Ansari was suggesting out here, the recent Supreme Court ruling on the maintenance of a Muslim woman, what's the difference? A woman had right to recourse under the Constitution, under CRPC 125 as well, and under the Muslim personal laws also. Whichever way you go, there is always a system under the Constitution for redressal of your grievances. So I don't think so. With a diverse plurality like India, where there are tribal customs, customary laws of the tribals, where there are Muslim personal laws, Sikh personal laws, or most of the other religious personal laws are there, which needs to be respected, because that's fundamental to the belief of a religious system. Like in Islam, what is the Sharia law out there? Most of the Sharia law are not being followed in India. We cannot say that the Sharia law is being implemented wholesale in India.
Correct.
But then there is always a recourse to the law. Congress party, while suggesting that the UCC may be desirable, but it cannot be enforced until a broader consensus is developed. Even in 1826, when Lord Bentinck abolished the Sati Pratha and the Widow Remarriage Act because of various social reformers like Raja Ram Mohan Roy and all these things, a reform came about in the society. So I also, as a personal belief from the Congress's point of view, I feel that there should be a consensus coming on this rather than imposing it to use it
when
as a political weapon.
When is the reform coming in among the Muslim society in Bharat, Kamru Chaudhary?
No.
Do we have to wait a few more centuries for that?
Yeah.
When will the Muslim Samaj in Bharat agree to uniform codification of these laws? And just like criminal acts, even civil contracts should be codified. Why
yeah,
should
Ananda, wonderful,
where is the plurality?
Question,
where is
question,
the plurality
Ananda,
in a secular Bharat when only the laws for Hindus are codified, but not for Sikhs, not for Muslims, not for Christians?
I understand, a wonderful question you have asked. Now let me take it into context with the Delhi University's introduction of the Manuspriti as a chapter in its studies out there. Now, do you consider a 2000-year-old Manuspriti as a benchmark for today's studies? I suppose none of you will be agreeing. But Tuhin Sinha will not denounce the Manuspriti out here.
But as of now, the education minister has said that there is no such move. It's not happening. So for you to use that against what the education minister has said and that there is no plan to introduce it is a falsified argument. One. Secondly,
not
sir.
A
no, no. One minute.
Outrage,
one minute. No. It's not about outrage, sir. You can, in your madrasas and Muslims can learn what is written in the Quran and the Sharia, which is 1500 years old, but a 2000 year old Manusmriti cannot be taught in Delhi University. Quite rich coming from the Muslim Samaj about this.
No, I never criticized the Manusmriti.
Why was there outrage? Who came out with the outrage about Manusmriti? Then look at the tone you use. No, then are you going to turn around and say that in Bharat we don't speak Arabic? So teach the Quran only in the local languages.
Teach it in Marathi, teach it in Assamia, teach it in Bengali,
and teach it in Bhojpuri and in this one, in Avadhi. Don't insist on Arabi, because we don't speak Arabi in Bharat. And it's a 2000, for the last 1500 years, 1400 years, sir, there has been no reform or no improvement that had happened. Islam continued to evolve 200 years since its inception. After that, it has not. That's what historians write, and I'm quoting them, and scholars have advised me.
Absolutely.
But so
can
then
I reply?
Should that be studied based on your own argument 1500 years later?
Can I reply?
Ji.
I do not want to suggest anything what has to be done or what not has to be done, because I said the Sharia law, as it is written in the Quran and the Hadith, is central to the belief system.
Sharia is
of
not
the
written
Muslims.
In the Quran, sir. If my
knowledge,
I'm subject
Hadith,
to correction.
You said it is written
in the Quran, sir.
I said both.
No, sir. The Sharia is not written in Quran. Sharia is part of the Hadith, sir.
I believe you are a greater scholar than anybody in this country.
No, I'm not a scholar, sir. This is what I was advised
that's
as a
what
Muslim,
you are suggesting,
as a Muslim
sir.
Scholar
I don't
who
want
told
to
me
shout
that the
over
Quran,
anything, but
sir,
it's
no,
an
no.
informed debate.
Sir,
so
the
I want
Hadith,
it to
yes.
be an informed
so
debate.
So the Hadith, sir. Yes. But the Hadith, yes. Very humbly, sir, the Hadith is different from the Quran, is what I have been advised by Muslim scholars, and that's what
yes,
I'm quoting.
Yes, of course.
And I'm
of
subject
course.
To correction. So the Sharia is part of the Hadith and not part of the Quran, is only that I said. You said Sharia is part of Quran. That's what I just objected.
I said the Sharia and the Hadith, I said, sir,
yes.
These are the way of life of the Muslims in India. And it's very central to the belief system of the Muslims in India. Even an Amna Haris Ansari, I'm sorry.
Amna Begum Ansari.
Amna Begum Ansari, if she was there in 1400 years ago, she would have received the same justice that she's receiving today. In fact, if I don't want to belittle anybody in this studio out here, but the fact remains, it was Islam,
sir,
that gave some legitimacy, some
please
rights
me
to the
Islam
Muslim
here.
Women.
Please.
One
Muslim
minute,
women, some 14, 1500 years ago.
Here is a suggestion, sir. Please let me know how many Islamic scholars from 1400 years ago, 1500 years ago, can you quote? I can quote you at least 25 to 30. Scholars who were the foremost in terms of intelligence, who were women among our Vedic scriptures, and they are known as rishis and munis. So in terms of respect and in terms of equality, in terms of secularity, sir, please, it's a little rich. The Buddhists respected women far greater. The and I'm not getting into the Jains, and I'm not getting into the other faiths also.
No,
but I'm
the
disrespect. You just now made it a competition between religions when you said 1500 years ago Islam gave women more rights than others.
This
no, sir, it didn't.
The Abrahamic faiths
have done to women what none of the other faiths have done. It is one of the Abrahamic faiths that put 6 lakh women across the middle during the Middle Ages, during the Dark Ages, across all of Europe on the stakes, calling them witches. So you please tell me, sir, it's quite rich when it comes to saying delivering justice for women, and we gave justice to women, sir. You're competing with another Abrahamic faith there. There are other faiths that have given far greater place for women. The Mesopotamian civilization, Aztec civilization, Mayan civilization are all documenting this. If you want to go back into civilizational history more than 1500 years ago, 2000 years ago. But Amna Begum Ansari, coming to the present, you would have got the same justice what you got, what you're getting today 1500 years ago, is what Mr. Kamru Chaudhary said. Do you agree, disagree?
I totally disagree. First of all, I want to say one thing. Please stop justification of oppression of women in the name of diversity and pluralism. That should not be your motive. Pluralism doesn't mean that you will also accommodate all the regressive practices of the community. You have to reform that as well. You will give them their way of living does not mean you will justify their inhuman practices as well, such as halala or muta marriages, which is still prevalent in the Indian Muslim society. I would say that it is atrocity against the women. First that. Second, please, every time we Muslim women come forward and speak for our right, stop teaching us Islam. We know our Islam. There is no central authority of the Islam. Every Muslims are allowed to read their Quran, to understand their Islam and follow their Islam as they understand it. Stop doing this, because that's how you control the women, by showing them the fear of the Islam. They can read for themselves. They can follow their religion. Third, the Sharia. Sharia, you can see everywhere in every country, there is a different interpretation. It is subject to interpretation, ijma, qiyas, a lot of things goes there. That's why if you read, see the Saudi Arabia, 10 years ago, they said that this is a part of the Sharia that women cannot drive. But now the same Saudi Arabia with the different interpretation saying that you can even wear the clothes the way you want. So do not say that this is a kind of God word. Only Quran is the God word for us. We take certain kind of morality from there. But Sharia is man-made. People interpret it and it can be changed.
And then I'll speak. Asif Sohail is also
third, if a Muslim living in the secular country follow the law of the land, doesn't follow the Sharia, doesn't mean he's not or she's not a good Muslim. There are Muslims in the West who are following the law of the land. Just like Indian Muslim here, we follow criminal secular law. And even the state in Uttarakhand and Goa, Muslim follow those UCC. We are still Muslim because we have 5 basic principles, that's it to be Muslim. So please stop bringing Islam whenever we talk about our rights. One more final thing, there are a lot of rights also in the Sharia. Indian Muslim do not practice it. Even the half inheritance, you go and ask any Indian Muslim women, do they receive it? No, they don't. Even the hajj, the practice of dowry should not be there in Islam, but every Indian Muslim follow it, most of them. So what is this? Only selective Sharia when it comes to the women rights? Sir, this is very hypocritical of you, and please do not teach me Islam.
See, there are errors in society. There are errors in society. Nobody is trying to teach anybody anybody's faith. But one of the unique aspects of Islam was for 200 years it continued to evolve. Even the Sharia evolved. And based on the times and places, laws were made so that how society can be there with perhaps protection to all, rights to all. Times were different. My question, Asif Sohail, is why do the fundamentalists want to take over and try to be the custodians of 27 crore Muslims in Bharat? Most of the 27 crore Muslims in Bharat are moderate. They live, with a modern thinking. They abide by the constitution. And if they can abide by the constitution for the criminal aspects of law, why not the civil contracts? And it's only these 5 platforms of birth, death, marriage, inheritance, and adoption. That's where the common code comes in. Why this entire issue? Why make it about one's faith? It's not about faith. It's about human-to-human contractual relations in a country and governing laws which protect everybody.
Sir, देखिए constitution ने हमें cultural और अपने religious rights दिए हैं, ठीक है? उसको क्यों हटाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं? मुझे बताइए सर, जब आप बात हो रही है one nation, one election, one religion, तो ये देखिए मुझे तो कोई angle से कोई एक uniform civil code नहीं सर, मुझे मेरी let me complete it सर. एक तरफ ये तो एक uniform civil code की बात कर रहे हैं, but ये तो clearly जो हो सो एक हिंदू civil code लाने की कोशिश की जा रही है, जिसमें मुस्लिम के rights, मुस्लिम cultural, सुनिए सर, मुस्लिम के जो rights है, मुस्लिम के जो cultural activities, तो खत्म करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं. कोड लाने की अगर बात हो रही है सर, गुजरात में देखिए आप वहाँ पे डिस्टर्बेंस एरिया एक्ट एक है, जहाँ पे मुसलमानों को घर नहीं दिया जाता, वहाँ पे इक्वालिटी की बात कहाँ से आ गई? आप बताइए, अगर उतना ही है तो लाना है तो एक तालीम के ऊपर एक कोड लाइए, आप एम्प्लॉयमेंट पे कोड लाइए. आज नीड ऑफ द आवर क्या है हमारा? रोटी कपड़ा और मकान है, यहाँ पे आप किस चीज के लिए?
आप इस बात के पक्ष में है कि राइट टू एजुकेशन मुस्लिम मदरसों में भी होना चाहिए?
नहीं नहीं सर,
मुस्लिम स्कूल्स में भी और नॉन
होना चाहिए,
नहीं है ना? अभी तो क्योंकि मुसलमानों ने मना किया कि राइट टू एजुकेशन हम नहीं सब्सक्राइब करेंगे।
मैंने चाइल्ड राइट एडवोकेसी में करता हूँ, मैं हमेशा तालीम के साथ होता हूँ। और सर उतना ही है तो हिंदू अनडिवाइडेड शेयर के ऊपर क्यों एबॉलिश नहीं किया जा रहा है मुझे बताइए। कल देखिए आप हम करते हैं, निकाह करते हैं, आप फेरे लेते हैं, क्रिश्चियन जो सबको क्या चीज से होगा मुझे बताइए।
नहीं, फेरों से किसी को कोई रोक नहीं रहा, चीज बनाया नहीं, जा रहा है। आप जो आर्गुमेंट देख, अगर आप आर्गुमेंट करना चाहते हैं, सुनिए,
आप क्या निकाह करेंगे कल?
आसिफ अगर आप आर्गुमेंट करना चाहते हैं तो मैं आपको एक बात बताना, मैं आपसे एक बात कह रहा था। देखिए आपके फेथ पर, आपके इबादत के तरीके पर क्वेश्चन नहीं, कल्चरल राइट्स नहीं दिए। एक मिनट, आपकी फंडामेंटल राइट सिर्फ आपके पंथ को फॉलो करना है, यानी कि आपके इबादत के तरीके को आप, नहीं, आपके इबादत के तरीके को आप फॉलो कर सकते हैं। शादी, तलाक, इनहेरिटेंस, यानी कि जो आपको संपत्ति इनहेरिट होती है, एडॉप्शन कि किसी बच्चे को गोद लेने की बात अगर होती है, और डेथ, ये पांच जो हैं ये कॉन्ट्रैक्चुअल तरीके से इसमें इसको देखे जाते हैं, इसको रिलीजियस प्रिज्म से नहीं देखा जाता। इसीलिए मैं आपको कह रहा हूं कि आप अगर आप इतिहास में देखें कि जिन्ना के समय में पाकिस्तान के जितने जमींदार थे और भारत के जितने मुस्लिम जमींदार थे, उन्होंने एडॉप्शन को अलाउ किया जबकि शरीयत इसकी इजाजत नहीं देता। क्यों? क्योंकि उनके बाद उनकी जागीर को कौन देखेगा, तो उन्होंने शरीयत को अलाउ किया उस शरीयत एक्ट में। उन्होंने एडॉप्शन को उस वक्त अलाउ किया क्योंकि वो उनके लिए
भाड़ में, मुझे कोई
भारत के हिंदुस्तानी में कह रहा हूँ, भारत के हिंदुस्तानी अभी भी उसको फॉलो कर रहे हैं। जो अमीर जमींदार थे वो आज भी फॉलो कर रहे हैं। मैं आपके केस में संविधान और कोर्ट ने ये कहा है कि हर मुस्लिम महिला को गुजारा भत्ता मिलना चाहिए, उसको एलिमनी मिलनी चाहिए, तो अब आप संविधान का आदर करेंगे कि नहीं करेंगे?
सर देखिए वो तो बराबर, सर इस्लाम तो पहले से दे रहा है गुजारा भत्ता। आज की बात क्या है सर, उसको बराबर जो 90 डेज का एक कॉन्ट्रैक्ट है सर,
नहीं, वन टाइम सेटलमेंट, वन टाइम सेटलमेंट नहीं होता सर।
सर देखिए, एक
अगर संविधान, अगर आप संविधान के हिसाब से चल रहे हैं तो सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने अभी ये कहा है कि महिला को सिर्फ वन टाइम सेटलमेंट नहीं होगा, वन टाइम नहीं, अभी आप संविधान की बात करिए, अभी आप इस्लाम की बात मत करिए।
मेरी बात तो,
जब कन्वीनियंट है तब संविधान, जब कन्वीनियंट है तब इस्लाम। तो इन सुना आसिफ सोहेल, एक मिनट, तो इन सुना, तो अब ही सेइंग इन आवर कंट्री इस्लामिक प्रैक्टिसेस हैव देमसेल्व्स गॉट corrupted. Now, if they have got corrupted and they're not being followed, and if the top court of the country has said that, listen, every woman, right to equality is a fundamental right. Every woman should be treated equally, and alimony rights are for every woman. So, Insina, where is the problem here? Is it convenience that somebody says Islam once and constitution the other? They are the same people who are saying save constitution, and they are the same people who are saying Islam superior than constitution.
Problem lies in their minds, you know. I heard Asif ji accusing ki aap log jo hai musalmanon ke culture par attack kar rahe hain. Agar kisi mahila ko mehngai bhatta milna, inke culture par kaise attack ho sakta hai? Ye chahte hain ki mahilaye hamesha piche rahe, and that is why I'm coming to the, you know, original point, the moot point that you had mentioned. It is important for state governments to raise the bar over here, and that is why it is important that in Assam, you know, the Assam government under Himanta Biswa Sarma has gone one step further. They are exploring ways to legally end polygamy, because in a modern society, such practices should have no role, because these are leading to dysfunctional society. These will eventually lead to dysfunctional society. So when you are having a frank discussion for the betterment of the society, I think, you know, Muslim intellectuals and the Congress ecosystem, which is probably more radical than Muslims themselves, need to come forward and explore and discuss these ideas.
The end point is, any scripture, be it the Quran, be it the Bhagavad Gita, be it any of the faiths, they have always held Raj Dharma or Rashtra Dharma at the highest level. So Habbal Watan is a quote which is there, which is part of Quran. So where it also says that you have to give your nation priority, nation supersedes everything else. So if the nation needs to have a certain uniformity for all its people so that there is equal justice to all, then we should rise above our individual personal differences and say, see, it's not that it's complicated and difficult only in Islam, Amna Begum Ansari. Even the Hindu Samaj, even the Jain Samaj, every other Samaj will have issues, because they all want to hold on to their own personal laws for their own conveniences. But we have to look at it as a nation. Are we ready? And will the 50% of the Muslim population of this country stand up together along with another 30% of the male population who agree largely that there should be a certain uniformity, barring a few fundamentalists? Amna Begum Ansari, final word.
There was a time when women were even against to get a voting right. So it is not about the majority, it is about what is right thing to do in the favor of nation and in the favor of human rights. Women are human and our rights are human right, and we have to talk about. And I do believe that every citizen of India, every citizen, my Hindu brother, my Hindu sister, they should also speak up. Don't we say that we belong to us, to Indian identity? So why this separation that you cannot speak in our matter? When we can speak about casteism as much as we want, about the Hindu casteism, Hindu should also stand up and talk about us. We have to have dialogue between them, among us.
But the change begins from within, and others speak about the Hindu society because there are many Hindus who are open enough to, and Hinduism or perhaps that way of life allows for criticism and for reform. And the reform comes from within. And I believe that reform has to come from every samaj. Unless we look at nation as a priority and uniformity across the board so that nobody's life is hindered, we are not going to be able to move forward. And we have to stop looking at it from a religion prism or a personal prism. It's got to be a common prism. That's my only submission. I have to wind up on that note. Thank you very much. Thank you to all our guests. Thank you. It's a happy day as Anant Ambani and Radhika Merchant tie the knot. Our heartiest congratulations and best wishes for a long, happy, blissful wedded life. Here's a glimpse into the celebrations.